Good evening, everybody. If we can take our seats and go ahead and get started, then we'll get you out of here faster. How's that sound? Well, it's good to be here with everybody. Sure is hot out there. Last night, the church had a pretty good blessing. We had the next popcorn night downtown where we're supporting the city, and we tried to keep track the best we could. At a minimum, we gave out 500 bags of popcorn last night. Probably a little bit more than that, but it was a really good night. And can I just say that this church works well together? You know, it's a piece of cake when you show up and there are other workers there alongside of you to help out and pitch in, and many hands do make light work. So, all right, well, we're going to do things a little different tonight. We're going to start off with a little game to play. Now, this is what you guys may not like to hear. I'm looking for 3 volunteers that are willing to come up here and sit on stage in these 3 chairs. We'll do Leanne. Come on up. Take a seat in one of the chairs. How about Wendell?
Yeah.
Wendell, would you come up?
Yeah, we'll go.
And one other. How about Lewis? Would you like to come up? Just leave your Bible there. Now, I really appreciate this. I know this puts you guys in the limelight. Now, I promise you, when I put people in the spotlight like this, I try to keep in mind not to embarrass you. So this is the way it's going to work, you guys. I'm going to tell you about a world record-setting catch. All right, we're talking about fish. And what you're going to have to do is, I'm going to give you 2 options. It's multiple choice. I'm going to give you 2 weights of that catch, an A and a B. And all you're going to decide is which weight you think that came in at, and write A or B, and then you're going to show it to me. All right? Any questions? No looking at other people's board. All right. So, number 1. In 1915, J.W. Cook reeled in a record-setting brook trout that weighed in at A, 14 pounds, 8 ounces, or B, 24 pounds, 2 ounces. So do you just write A or B? When everybody's got their answer, we're going to go ahead and flip it. So Lewis, you just write A or B. All right, let's see your answers. Is that an A, Wendell? What is that one? Is that an A or B? Wendell is correct with A. Go ahead and erase that. Good job, Wendell. So now you guys know all you got to do is write A or B, okay? Number 2. In 2005, Sarah Hayward caught a wahoo weighing A, 75 pounds, 1 ounce, or B, 184 pounds. A or B? A is 75 and 1 ounce pounds, or B, 184. All right, let's see your answers. The correct answer is B. Leanne and Wendell get a point. Okay, number 3. We got 7 of these. Number 3. In 1979, Ken Frazier logged a bluefin tuna weighing A, 979 pounds, or B, 1,496 pounds. Everybody got an answer? All right, go ahead and show me. The correct answer is B, 1,496 pounds. Wendell got another one. Number four, in 1955, David Hayes hooked a smallmouth bass weighing A, 11 pounds, 15 ounces, or B, 16 pounds, 12 ounces. Everybody got an answer? All right, show me. The correct answer is A, 11 pounds, 15 ounces. Good job, Lewis. Yeah. I got the points. Number five. In 1964, W. Whaley lured a channel catfish weighing A, 58 pounds, or B, 71 pounds, 4 ounces. A channel catfish. Everybody ready? All right, let's see it. The correct answer is A. Good job, Leanne. Number six. In 1960, Mabry Harper caught a walleye weighing A, 25 pounds, or B, 62 pounds. Everybody got an answer? All right, let's see it. The correct answer is A, so Lewis and Wendell get a point. And number seven, in 1932, George Perry registered a record-setting largemouth bass weighing A, 17 pounds, 10 ounces, or B, 22 pounds, 4 ounces. Let's go ahead and see them. And you all got the correct answer. So the good news is we have a winner, but we've got a tie for second and third. So Lewis and Leanne, I'm going to ask you one more, just you two. You don't need to write down anything. The first one to say A or B, that will be yours, and the other person will get the other letter, okay? In 1983, a white sturgeon was caught by Joey Pelota. Did it weigh A, 468 pounds, or B, 568 pounds? Lewis is correct. It was A. Let's give him a round of applause, everybody. Now, hold on, hold on. You cannot. Leanne, because you were willing to come up here, you have won yourself a bag of goldfish. Give her a round of applause. All right, you can go ahead and take a seat, Leanne. Leanne, you can go ahead and take a seat. Lewis, because you got second, you get a bag of Swedish fish. Yep. Don't eat that all at one sitting, Lewis. And Wendell. Because you won first, you won a message in a bottle of fish. Right. Now, I don't think I have to tell you what has to happen with that. So, you got to give it to a fisherman. All right, you guys can take a seat.
No, he's not going to give it
to me. All right, I really appreciate you guys being willing to come up here and play along. All right, enough fun and games, right? If you have your Bibles, please turn to Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. This past Sunday, I really appreciated Eli's words of encouragement when he said for us to go fishing with Jesus. You guys remember when he said that? He said it one time in his sermon, and it went in and it went out. And that kind of stuck with me as the week kind of started to unfold for me. And I thought that maybe we needed to talk about it a little bit more this Wednesday. So I think that Eli did a really good job giving us a visual and showcasing Jesus as the greatest fisherman of all time. Amen. Would you agree with that? Jesus caught so many fish in that set of scriptures that the fishermen's nets were breaking. The boats were being weighted down. You know, what a great visual for us to see. And I mean, have you ever heard of another fisherman being able to do that? Jesus, every single day, reels in new believers. He casts his line. He sets it for deep waters, down where it's good and dark and murky and dangerous. And he hooks believers, and he pulls them out of that darkness, and he brings them into the light every single day. In Mark 4, we are blessed to be able to re-experience one of Jesus' greatest and most memorable human catches, right? Eli's example gave Jesus helping catch actual fish out in the ocean. So I thought, well, maybe tonight I'll give an example of him catching a human fish. So that's what we're going to look at. We're going to pick things up on the Sea of Galilee in Mark chapter 4, starting at verse 35. There it says, "And the same day when the even was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and he said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Let us pray. This evening we call upon the greatest fisherman. We ask for your presence here with us tonight, Lord. We pray that you can open up these scriptures to us. We ask that you can help us to understand them more. We pray for your conviction to leave here tonight and maybe see a little bit more of the importance of going fishing alongside you, Lord Jesus. There are so many fish in the sea that need to be caught. And there are so many fishermen that can go out there and assist you. Sadly, that number is few. So maybe tonight, Lord, you can rise up a few more fishermen. You can help us, lead us, nurture us, train us up, and show us how to go out and be fishers of men, just like you told Peter and Andrew. Help us to follow you, Lord. We ask this all in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. So, those first set of scriptures, one of the things I think we can take from that is if you are going to choose to go fishing with Jesus, it's not always going to be easy. There are going to be times when the storm comes up, rises up against you. There are going to be times when you want to question the circumstances of what's going on, and you might even question Jesus about if he's committed to you and the situation at hand. There's going to be chaos. There's going to be a whole lot of fear, which we learn when Jesus finally addressed his disciples in the boat. A whole lot of fear. But the good news is, no matter how big or how small the storm is that rises up against us, Jesus will never leave us nor forsake us. And when the time is right, just like he did on that day, when the time is right, he will rise up and he will bring calmness and peace to our situation, especially when it comes to being a fisherman alongside him. For those desiring to fish alongside Jesus, one of the most important things we can do is recognize that Jesus is at the helm. All right, when you look at those scriptures, where was Jesus at to begin? He was in the hinder part of the boat, right? He was in the back. Let me tell you one thing. That situation did not surprise Jesus. That situation did not catch him by surprise. All right? He had the storm at hand, right where he wanted it to be. All right? He may not have been standing at the helm, but he was at the helm of that ship. Right.
And he said, well, and he did it so that they would understand that this is why you don't have faith in me. That I know what's going on, and this is why you need to trust me.
Right.
And he was building their faith, too, and their trust in him.
Right. He was. You know, this storm, where did it leave the disciples at? They were in a state of disarray, right? Chaos had hit the boat. I mean, they're scurrying around, trying to figure out what to do. Wendell.
And the thing about it is, some of these were very experienced sailors.
Right.
I mean, they made their living fishing on the Sea of Galilee. They were scared.
Right. And something we're going to learn in our next set of scriptures is that even though this storm's going on, you think about a boat getting, you know, rocked back and forth, up and down, left, right, getting thrown in every direction, that they don't really have any say in where they're going. That ship never lost course of where they were intended to go. Jesus, even though the disciples were in disarray and the disciples had lost control, Jesus had them still on course. And we're going to see that in the next scriptures, because Jesus had them heading for the country of the Gadarenes. And at that location, there was a special place that they were to dock that boat that next day, a place no one else would have led them but Jesus. You know, you think about fishing, and we're talking about fishing with Jesus. If we had some fishermen in here, which we probably do, they would probably tell you, oh yeah, I got a spot. I got a couple spots that I like to go to. I always catch the big fish there, right? Jesus knew the spots better than anybody, all right? And Jesus had a spot that he had decided that they needed to go to, and now they're preparing to dock at that location. And we know that this was Jesus' plan, because whose idea was this? Look at verse 35 again. And the same day when the even was come, he saith unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. This was Jesus' fishing excursion. This wasn't anybody else calling these shots, okay? So, any comments anybody wants to make before we get into our second set of scriptures?
Well, I think it was even more scary to the disciples, because fear
Right.
And they didn't have the lights and stuff like we had, so they were in the dark. And that made it even more frightening to them.
Right.
And one thing we can learn is Jesus was there, but he didn't respond until they came to him. You know, how many times are we in trouble? How many times are we worried? And the last thing we do is go to Jesus when we're at our end of our rope, so to speak, when we should have went to him at the beginning of the situation.
Right. Right.
They were going to the gathering because I think that's where God knew that's where the place where there was the most spiritual fishing to do.
Right. I'm really glad you guys said what you did because, you know, I don't have a lot of experience fishing with Jesus. I do have a little bit of experience, though, and I will say that for me personally, leading up to that moment of truly fishing, right, truly getting the gospel out there can be a very scary time. A lot of times that's the time where you get discouraged and you don't go through with what it is you're trying to go through with or what it is God's telling you to do. So thank you for sharing that, you two. Yep. All right. But today we're talking about spiritual fishing, right? Mark 5, verses 1 through 15. It says, "And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshiped him, and cried with a loud voice, and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, What is thy name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, Send us into the swine, that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out, and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea, for they were about 2,000, and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled, and told it in the city and in the country, and they went out to see what it was that was done. And they come to Jesus, and see him that was possessed with the devil, and had the legion sitting and clothed, and in his right mind, and they were afraid." I mean, what a great fishing example. There's a lot of examples like that in the Bible. This is just one that I so happened to fall upon this week. You know, something that's interesting and a mindset that I didn't acquire until a little bit later into my salvation was that when you talk about fishing, most people think, all right, well, we got to go to the water to fish, right? That's not what Jesus teaches his followers. He teaches his followers, you got to go to land to fish. That time on the boat, they weren't fishing. They were dealing with the storm. That was just leading up to the time when they were going to be fishing, when they docked. So Jesus, he reeled in a big one in these scriptures. He had the man on the line before he even stepped out of the boat. He had locals that chimed in these scriptures. Did those locals try to make the catch that Jesus did? Yeah. They tried to catch him. They tried to catch him a lot, didn't they? And what happened every time? You ever heard of that fish that got away? You had him on the line, you were reeling him in, and the line snapped? That was this guy.
Yeah, they were trying to capture him in their idea of wellness.
Right. Yeah.
Wondering what's going to happen to him.
Right.
Separate from the man.
Right.
I wonder how many times when we witness to people that we can measure the difference between the evil that's within man and the desire to be something other than that. You know, because God calls people to be saved.
Right.
Person, but the evil within them recognizes Jesus and tries to convince the person to walk away. And it's interesting that the disciples or the people in the boat were just merely observers. They just seen the miracle of the calming of the storm.
Right.
I find that in my life a lot, is that I cut God short. I'm following him, but I'm following from a distance rather than up close. And I miss the opportunity to lead people to Christ or to serve other Christians.
Right. Well, you know,
how many people read a lot of these verses and they give up the number? Because I don't think I ever really understood. He had 2,000 like demons.
Right.
Cared about the man.
Thank you. Yeah. Now, if you guys get one thing from tonight, walk away with one thing, this would be the one thing. Verse 3 says that no man could bind this individual. No man. Okay? He was too powerful. He kept getting free. Man alone cannot hook a soul. If there's one truth you walk away with, it's that man alone cannot hook a soul. If you're out there and you're truly trying to fish for a soul, it all begins with Jesus. Terry talked about a struggle with that, being in the distance, being afar off. We got to try to get as close as we can to him, because that's the only way that we're going to be able to catch a true soul, is if Jesus is the one to do the catching, right? On our own, it's not going to work. Just like every townsperson who tried to catch this man, it wasn't going to work. There was only one that could truly catch this man, and that was Jesus. So, when you fish with Jesus, the impossible becomes possible. All right? So this was a man who was loud, he was fierce, he was naked, cut up, unrestrainable, untamable. He was filled with devils who had been tormenting him for a long time. And with all that being said, we see our Lord and Savior, the greatest fisherman of all time, have a vision on the other side of the body of the water, say, you know what? We need to set sail. We're going over to the other side of the sea. We saw the greatest fisherman calm a storm. We saw the greatest fisherman look at his crew in disarray and perhaps stop a mutiny. We saw Jesus come ashore on the other side and make an unbelievable catch. That's what fishing with Jesus can be like. Wendell. Right. Lewis.
Well, I was handing out tracts last Tuesday. What was it, yesterday? And I noticed that as they went by, some of them would take the tracts, some of them would. But not one time was I able to get somebody to talk with me and get saved. You know what I mean? I didn't know what to do.
Right. And Lewis, you know, not to go into great detail of what Jeff was talking about last Wednesday, but he's told us numerous times in the past that a good approach to take to kind of break the ice with talking to individuals is just ask if there's something that you can pray for them for. You know, you give them a track, and maybe you don't go right into, you know, scriptures of salvation. Maybe you just say, hey, you know, if there's anything I can pray for you about, please let me know. And if they say something, Lewis, you can have prayer right then and there, and you can start, you can change the trajectory of that conversation into a spiritual conversation. And you get into that prayer, you can start pulling out any scriptures you got memorized, you know, and start getting them out there for them to hear. So that's just one technique. Eli. Right. 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 Good point. Right. Right. I believe every word of that. Right. So we're gonna switch things up here a little bit. All right? Who here is glad that Jesus chose to go fishing for your soul? Can I see a show of hands? Who in here is glad that? Okay. Now, hands went up all through the building. There are countless fishing tales right in here about how Jesus did that. And I thought, you know what? Maybe I just give an option to you guys. If there's anybody that just wanted to, you know, sum it up real quick or anything like that, just give somebody an opportunity to give thanks for the moment when they got saved. When Jesus went fishing for your soul. Anybody want to share anything? Lewis?
When I was 13, I had spent the whole seventh grade fighting with my friends. I was fighting and getting more and more depressed. When the time was almost for me to get out of seventh grade, the dean of students told me,
I've known you quite a while, Lewis, and I've never heard that. Thank you. Anybody else? Terry. Amen.
So it didn't matter about heaven, it didn't matter about New Jerusalem, it didn't matter about anything. I'd go anywhere with Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Terry. You know, we got two testimonies right there, two emotional testimonies. And if we all gave those testimonies, we could probably all get a little emotional about it. And we should get emotional about it. But the reason that I wanted to hear one or two of those is for us to see that kind of emotion and what happens when Jesus went fishing for us. We've seen what it was like for that man when Jesus went fishing for him in those scriptures. And something else that these scriptures open up to us is that Jesus cares about others.
Amen.
He cared about his disciples. He wanted to teach them how to be fishers of men. He cares about the lost. He wants to reach them. So with that being said, I'm going to end with one more little excursion here for everybody. I'd like you all to please close your eyes. And what I want you to do is I want you to try to visualize some of the people that God has put in your life. All right, just start having them kind of swim around in your mind a little bit. Family, friends, neighbors, just start thinking of people. Now what I'd like you to do is try to start focusing in on one person. One person that has been swimming around you that you feel perhaps has never been caught by Jesus. I'd like you to bring that person, if you got one, right out onto the surface of your mind. Does anybody have anybody there? Raise your hand if you got somebody there right now on your mind, somebody that you don't think is saved. Okay, you can put your hands down. Keep your eyes closed because we're going to pray. We call upon you, the greatest fisherman, once more, Lord. We know that we need to be mindful of others, that we need to love you, and that we need to love our neighbor. And tonight, Lord, we've been blessed with an interesting set of circumstances. We've seen how emotional it can be when you go fishing and when you reach a soul. And Lord, some in this building tonight, they've even been able to pull out one specific face, one specific name out of the many that you've surrounded them with. And they brought that out onto the surface. And Lord, we want to say a special prayer tonight that you be with those individuals who raise their hands, that you help them to call upon you as the great fisherman to lead the way and to take their hand and maybe reach out to that individual on their mind. You know who they are, Lord. You know whether you've gotten that soul or not. But Father, moving forward, we just ask that you please touch those individuals that may not know you. Help us as believers to come alongside you and help fish those souls with you, Lord. And we'll give you the thanks and praise always. Amen. All right, everybody. Thank you for everything you shared tonight. Let's go ahead and take a...